Okay, I think we're up and running now. If you can hear me and see me, let me know on Twitter so we can make sure these technical difficulties are out of the way. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to IWO Brunch. I am your host, Stephen Place, the head trader and founder over at investingwithoptions.com. If you're new to the show, thank you so much for coming out. This is an hour-long show. The first half hour discusses the overall global macro conveyor belt, stocks, bonds, currencies, commodities. The second half goes over individual requests that I take in live via social media on StockTwits and Twitter. At Stephen Place is my StockTwits and Twitter handle if you want to go ahead and send some my way. So we're getting off to a little bit of a slow start today because my computer decided to completely break on me. But we're going to go ahead and get started with a quick look. There we go. We're going to move this around. With a quick look at some futures. And we're going to look at, let's see, what's the best way to do this? We're going to focus on the ES futures. So these are the S&P 500 futures. The overall trend right now is still up. And while everyone is looking for some sort of correction, remember that there are two ways that a market can correct. It can correct through price, or it could correct through time. Okay? We've been undergoing a time correction. There has been a line in the sand in the ES around 1302 to 1305, give or take. Just this area of support. Every time we come back and dip into that area, we have found buyers. That condition has persisted since the 19th. Okay? So we can make the case for, you know, that support level holding since last Thursday. We have been making higher highs, okay, so we have this pattern going on. And so this is, we could make the case for a broadening triangle pattern. And this could be construed as a bearish pattern on the condition that we break underneath 1300. If we don't, and if we continue to find buyers, and this trend does in fact continue, then that was the correction, that was the consolidation, okay? If we go to a longer term chart, and this is a 4-hour chart, it's got some other stuff on it, but since the beginning of the year, we've been in an uptrend. And this is a fairly well-defined uptrend. Friday, with the weakness that we had in the S&P, we did close right around that support level. So I am watching those two levels, that 1300, 1305 support level, as well as some trend line support as we come into next week. The main thing I want to impress upon you this week is the lack of correlations. Okay, we have seen a fairly large correlation breakdown whereby not everything is moving on the same conveyor belt right now. Okay, so while the S&P finished flat on the week or thereabouts, there are underlying stocks that have tremendous technical setups, and the momentum shifts in and out of individual sectors, and this has been a very tradable market. Contrast that with last quarter, where everyone's concerned about Europe. There is very high gap risk, okay? Everything is moving up and down. We saw 90% up days, 90% down days. Correlations were at an extreme, okay? These are two different, completely different markets. And if you're trying to trade the current market right now, like the market that we saw back in the fourth quarter of 2011, then it has not been a successful year for you so far, okay? However, if you switched gears, saw that the correlations could potentially break down, saw that volatility could be due for a little bit of a move lower, and you focused on individual equities that showed good technical setups, you have been outperforming the market. That's just how this game has been played. Now, will this condition persist for the rest of the year? No, that's not how it works. The market moves in cycles, up-down cycles, volatility cycles, and trend mean reversion cycles, okay? And correlation is a part of that volatility cycle. The market is really not showing a whole lot of weakness right here. And we'll just look at the S&P, and we'll move over to the NASDAQ as well. But we have a couple trend lines to watch. We have this trend line right here. We have a secondary trend line, underneath that. It's kind of running in parallel. And I'm sure if we you know, connected some channel lines here and everything like that. It's just been a mathematically consistent and very steady, low volatility uptrend. Okay. Personally, I would prefer a 3-5% correction. Will I bet a lot of money on it? Not a chance, because I've seen this market before. This is a market very similar to what we saw back in late 2010, where we saw a couple gaps up and the move was fueled higher by skepticism, where people said, you know, we're going to revert. We've still got issues out of Europe. We saw these gaps that need to be filled. We've got potential resistance here, here, and here. And it never came. And it eventually spawned the fear of missing out rally, where people were now scared of upside and missing out on further upside, which then led to a trend change. But we're nowhere near that sort of cycle right now, I think. So, yeah, I want to pull back to 1300, maybe 1275 on the S&P. I think that would be really nice. I don't know how easily that will come, just given the strength of the tape right now. On top of that, before I go into that, we are in earnings season. We've seen decent price reactions out of earnings season, and that may in fact be driving this market. You know, we talk about Federal Reserve and liquidity, but oftentimes we will see a trending market during earnings season. After a lot of companies report, then it starts to taper off, then we see the mean reversion. That's another possibility, so keep an eye out on your calendars. Let's take a look at the Qs, and we're at 11-year highs. If we back this out, I think this goes all the way back, but we can look at a chart of the NDX cash. We are breaking out right here. We're at 11-year highs. If we back this out to a 20-year chart, these are price levels not seen since 2001, since the tech crash. Okay, so there is a very strong trend, and for an investor to ignore the fact that there is a breakout going on right now is sheer folly, in my opinion. This is not me leaning aggressively bullish. It's just that you have to respect this tape. You have to respect the fact that capital is currently being flowed into these names, and we are seeing some decent beats, and we are seeing just a lot of capital starting to get allocated into these areas and into this tech area. So this is a breakout. When these breakouts happen, generally they continue in the context of the trend. Would I prefer a 5% pullback? Yeah, absolutely. But it's not happening right now. What I would not like to, you know, if you want to be constructively bullish on this market, okay, first off, just on the NASDAQ, we have an inclining 5, 10, 20, 50, and 200-day moving average. They are all in bullish alignment right now, okay? That's the equivalent of the stars aligning for a very strong trend and very low risk relative to the downside. If we start to lose this 2375 level, okay, that was sort of the start of the very strong move higher, then you start to apply some caution, and ideally you would start to apply some caution on a shorter term time frame. Now, you may be saying right now, well, what about Europe? What about a hard landing in China? What about all this other macro stuff? And yeah, you're right. There will come a point in time in which this macro voodoo, again, will start to matter. But as it stands right now, that's not the kind of market we're in. Okay? And that's a completely different set of trading processes you'll be using, but that's just not what's going on right now. Individual setups, individual stocks have been playing very well, and it's one of those markets where honestly you haven't had the need to be staring at the overnight futures market to see where we're going to end up, or you know, just looking at constantly hedging your position with TZA or TNA and so on. Okay, completely different market that we're in. We can also look at the IWM, which is the Russell 2000 index, and this too has seen a breakout with no evidence of letting up so far. Would I prefer a pullback to 75? Yes, absolutely. I want to put my mean reversion hat on, but there's really not much evidence that leads me to believe we're due for any sort of steep correction right now. Okay, and it's one of those where I feel stupid for saying that, and I feel like, you know, if we get caught at the top, I'm going to look very, very foolish, but that's not the game that we're playing right now. I'm trying my best to you know, when we trade, we're trying to put our risk in the direction of the trend, whatever time frame it may be, in the best basis possible. Okay, and right now the current trend is up. There is very low downside risk, extreme downside risk, like taking the IWM back to 65. And there's just not much evidence right now to say that we're going to weaken up. All right. Now, let's go into a 30-minute chart, and if we get some sort of topping pattern and we make a lower high, lower low, then you can get much more defensive. But this is not, you know, it's not an incredibly defensive market right now. That's just not what we're in. Let's take a look at volatility. And I do have some notes on this. You know, I've been saying that volatility, implied volatility, is oversold. And, you know, if we do get that correction, okay, in the market, that 3 to 5% correction, we should see the VIX come back into the low 20s, and that would be a wonderful opportunity, in my opinion, to be selling volatility. But the way that we've been trading is very similar to, okay, this 2010 level. Need my caffeine. Okay, we've, you know, back in April, May of 2010, that's when we saw Europe issues start to present themselves again. Saw a big spike up in the VIX, and then it didn't necessarily get resolved. It's just that liquidity came back into the system. Implied volatility started to get crushed, and then it started on this very, very slow pace whereby the pattern resembles a falling wedge, okay, where the rate of change continues to the downside. We saw the same thing August through October of 2011. Saw Europe issues start to take hold again, a lot of fear, big spike up in the VIX, and then this slow crawl to the downside, okay? There is a natural floor in the VIX right now of around 15, okay? And I think, you know, if you are going to continue to play the upside right now, and I say, yes, there's no downside risk, but the price of insuring against downside risk is really, really cheap right now. So you could consider doing call conversions, you could consider doing protective puts and put buying and index hedging right now, because it's pretty cheap relative to where we are. But the VIX is currently at 18.53, and I say it's cheap, but if we look at the actual volatility in the SPX, okay, we currently have a historical volatility. So that's the volatility that we've seen on a 1 month time frame backwards. Okay, it's currently at 9. Okay, option traders will use the comparison of a 20-day historical volatility to a 30-day implied volatility, which is the VIX. 20 days, 20 trading days is 1 month. 30 calendar days for the VIX, that's 1 month. So 1 month forward, 1 month backward. Volatility for the past month has been 9. Okay, the VIX is currently at 18. There's still a 9-point premium. Okay, so If this kind of volatility condition persists, we will continue to see volatility come through the floor, okay? And, you know, a 6-point premium would seem much more reasonable. If we have a historical volatility at 9, that's a VIX of 15, okay? I don't see that happening, but for me to say that, there is a little cognitive dissonance here saying, all right, you know, The trend is up, but we're due for a volatility pop. We need a correction and so on. And there's just a lot of crossroads going in on my mind. And I feel that, you know, that kind of condition is going through a lot of people saying, well, yeah, the trend's up. I want to allocate capital. But, you know, what if the market pulls back, right? And we've seen that happen. And that was back in, you know, the second half of 2010. And that's just what we've been playing on. Let's move over to, what do we want to play with? Currencies. The dollar's falling out of bed. And this was on the back of some not bad news out of Europe, I guess, and some Federal Reserve notes that came out on Friday. So we've started to see a pretty strong correction in the dollar. This has led to a fairly strong bid up in gold and, I would say, equities, right? If this trend continues down in the dollar, we will most likely see continued rise in equities, right? So what I'm going to show you really quick is the current correlation between the S&P and the dollar, okay, on a 1 month basis. And you can see that, you know, it's starting to switch back to a liquidity based environment, Okay, this yellow line is the zero line. When we have a negative correlation between the dollar and equities, that generally means that there's some sort of liquidity voodoo going on with respect to the central banks. And during the first half of this year, okay, or the first half of this month, rather, we've been above zero, okay, because there's been, you know, there was a rally in equities, right, while the euro didn't make any move, while the dollar didn't make any move, okay, and I, you know, that was a potential bearish divergence, but right now, the euro is running higher and the dollar is running lower, and the divergence is being closed to the bullish side right now, okay? I could make the case and say the dollar is at support, and if the dollar bounces right here, we'll see a pullback in equities. That's what I'd like, but, you know, that's wishful thinking. There's not a whole lot of evidence right now to say there's going to be a confirmed break to the downside in equities, okay? Let's move over to the euro. And I've been calling for, you know, not necessarily a bottom. It's just one of those where FXE, which is an index for the euro, the euro dollar cross, it's an ETF or whatever, they have options, and those options were cheap. And the ability to play upside calls with very, very limited downside was a pretty reasonable bet. And I said that last week and 2 weeks ago that FXE call buys probably made sense right here. And, you know, that kind of trade is doing fairly well. I think that I feel that the trade in the euro got a little too leaning short. It was too obvious. A lot of funds were loaded up in short euro, and we are seeing a little squeeze right there. That coupled with liquidity-driven stuff from the Federal Reserve and very, very low interest rates going forward has probably helped this rally, okay? Probably helped this market rally. Let's take a look at the Aussie dollar, AUD, USD. And this is coming into a big level of resistance at 107.42. The overall trend on a daily chart is pretty bullish right now. But we are coming into that level. Now, the Aussie is a big indicator for me on a macro perspective because it's part of the carry trade. It's a proxy for global risk, global growth, China, Pac Rim, and everything like that. And so when we see the Australian dollar run higher, that's showing sort of an aggressive risk on measure. Okay. A quicker way to look at all the carry trade is DBV. This is the PowerShares Currency Harvest Fund. And this has signaled an all clear in that I have this longer term trend line right here and it broke above it. Okay. And that's fairly bullish for the risk environment when we see DBV, when we see the carry trade start to work well. Okay. Back in 2008, the carry trade rolled over before the equity markets did. So this can be construed as a leading indicator. Definitely keep an eye out on that. Let's move to commodities. I think the biggest mover so far, at least the most attention, is being driven towards gold, okay, GLD. There is a level of resistance coming up at 171.50. If we get to 177 in short form and GVZ spikes, I think that will be a fade, okay? But this longer-term pattern, you know, gold is very, very similar to Apple. Need more caffeine. Gold is very similar to Apple. It is overanalyzed. Everyone's got an opinion. People who don't trade the markets always have an opinion. And gold will have moments of brilliance for about 2 months and then get into a big ugly range for 6 months, three to six months. Have a failed breakdown. Everyone says, okay, the run in gold is over. We had a failed breakdown here back in December to January, right? And then it runs higher again. That's just how gold trades, okay? I think gold, you know, I think you can still play the range. I think it's fadeable at about 177. If we get a spike up in GVZ, which is the VIX for gold, up into the 25 level, I think iron condors looking for reversion would be a really nice trade. And it's looking, you know, the overall pattern is pretty good. I'm just expecting some resistance to come through at about 170 to 175. Silver did see a nice bid on Friday's close last week, and everyone was talking about it, and that trend did continue. Silver is coming into a level that could potentially be resistance as well. Okay, and if we back this out, silver's been in a giant correcting channel since last May. Okay, and that was a big parabolic spike higher. If you take this off to an arithmetic chart, you can see the parabolic move, and it's just been a longer term correction. Okay, we could make the case and say that the trend in silver is not yet done. Okay, and that it's just taking a lot of time to work itself out, you know, shake out the weak hands, and potentially make a new move higher. That coincides with the macro voodoo with, you know, central banks that could work. I don't think that the trend is up yet on a longer-term basis. I think silver most likely needs some more time to work itself out, and if concerns about Europe start to persist again, we'll most likely see a rollover there. Oil has not seen much of a move. And this is really interesting because, you know, I put out an article for the SFO last week about potentially buying volatility in oil, and it's been the wrong trade so far. Oil, USO is a quick proxy to look at oil. And I'm just going to open this really quick, make sure that this is all working. Oil's been in a big range, and it is potentially putting in an inverse head and shoulders. We're coming into the summer driving months and everything like that. I think the energy patch is potentially due for a move higher. I really like how XLE is shaping up. Okay, we've got this longer-term trend line that did break, failed a little bit, but the true breakout will come around 73.17. The major integrated oil and gas looks not bad right here. And just, you know, individual oil plays could be in play here soon. Okay, and a couple of them have been running. I like Halliburton here. I like Schlumberger. If it does break right here, I think this 77.5 is a critical level on Schlumberger. You can short it under. You can get long above. Play that pivot. Okay, we'll just leave it there. Natural gas did see some short covering, and everyone says, okay, now the bottom is in natural gas, and that, you know, this was a high volume capitulatory move to the downside, and I talked about it last Saturday, and I said, you know, it's probably going to be a good trade, but it's not the right or easy trade to take. There are easier trades to devote your mental capacity towards compared to natural gas. Okay. A lot of names looking interesting right now, though. Cabot is one I like. If it can clear 34, they just had a split. That's a natural gas name. Chesapeake is another one to watch. I'm not a big fan of playing UNG. I'm not a big fan of just getting long straight natural gas. I think proxy plays are a better bet. Chesapeake still has more work to be done. Southwestern Energy could be a decent play above 32.75. Okay. What else? We did gold, we did oil, we did silver. We did, let's take a look at some agricultural commodities, DBA, really quick. Putting in a potential sort of a inverse head and shoulders bottom. It needs to get and hold above that 29.30 level. The agriculture space is looking pretty good. Potash had a really nice move post-earnings. Mosaic isn't looking half bad for a move, maybe up to 60. CF is right now the big leader in the space, and it's looking good. I want to fade it, but you know, the tape is looking really nice right now. We did agriculture futures. Let's take a quick look at base metals, DBB. And this is China. You know, the demand for... What's in base metals? Steel and copper and everything like that, I'm pretty sure is in that. But when you see a strong bid in this, it indicates that the expectation in the market for resurgent economic activity, both in the U.S. and abroad, is continuing to pick up. Okay, and so when you see that and you see names like U.S. Steel, which could be breaking out of multi-month bottoming formations, that could be worth a look. One particular space that really hasn't moved that much is coal. If we look at, let's just say, ANR, This one hasn't moved yet, but if we start to see a bid in coal, and I think there are a couple earnings reports, that might be worth a look. We could look at Walter Energy, which I'm pretty sure is in the coal space, and they're probably going to get bought out by BNP. We've got, let's just take a quick look at ACI, and that could, if it breaks underneath 13 and a third is a short, but if it breaks above this trend line right here, above 15, give or take, that could be worth a look, okay, for potential bottoming formation, all right? So, you know, the coal space has not moved with the rest of the market relative to the move we've seen, and that might be worth a spot to take a look at. Let's take a quick look at Treasuries. Treasuries, TLT, has broken underneath the trend line, and it's starting to retrace a little bit. If, you know, when we see, okay, just in general, when we see Treasuries sell off very aggressively and the S&P being bid up very aggressively, that indicates a move out of risk aversion, okay, and very low interest rate bearing Treasuries, into domestic equities and sort of a risk-on environment, okay? So when the trend in this relationship changes, it often indicates the difference between a bear market and bull market. Now, Ron, you know, GTO Toy has a really nice chart that showcases this, the relative performance of the S&P to TLT. Dynamic Hedge has a proprietary relationship to stocks and bonds and stuff like that, and he showed a chart, and you know, it showcases exactly what's going on there. And all of these could be making a little bit of a change that could signal a longer term trend change in this relationship. This is a chart that shows the relative performance of the SPY to TLT, and you can see that this does cycle with the rest of the market when this started to get weak and this started to diverge while the S&P was continuing to make new highs. That shows, you know, potentially more risk aversion coming through. And as you can see right now, we've been in this basing pattern right here. And if this trend starts to go, you know, if we start to see a trend to the upside in this, and we start to see more capital being allocated to the S&P relative to bonds, then that will most likely lead to a more sustainable trend to the upside in the S&P. If we see a big failure, if, you know, Europe starts to matter again and volatility starts to pick up, then that thesis will be shot, okay? All right, let's go into some individual requests. At Stephen Places, my Twitter and StockTwits handle, thank you all so much for coming out. We're going to start off with Wiser Guy 1971. He's looking at SPRT. And we're going to focus on 6-month daily charts, okay, and then zoom out if we need to get some more information. Support.com had a very nice high volume move over the past few days. It did break out above this. It's extended right now. I could make the case for potential continuation, but I would focus on a shorter term chart. And you could do a breakout above 275 as a buy stop, but it already has started its move. It's most likely, from a risk-reward standpoint, it's going to be a little bit more difficult to stay in that kind of area. MTG, okay, MGIC investment company, it's kept its trend, and it's getting pinched between the 250-day moving average. I don't know which way it's going to head. But it is due for an expansion in volatility. Okay, earnings are already out of the way. You could make the case for if it gets above 450, you buy it. Okay, and that's the recent resistance level. If it clears above that, that could be worth a look. I'm going to zoom out a little bit and go to a one-year chart to see if there's anything else. Yeah, 450. If it breaks above 450, that could be worth a look with an expected move to 552. Okay, PKD, I think we just talked about that one. No, we didn't. Parker Drilling Company, high volume sell-off on probably some sort of news. It's potentially putting in a bear flag. If it rolls underneath that 612 level, then you need to be shorting it or significantly reducing exposure. And you've got a big pivot level at about $7 a share, okay, around those levels. And if it does rally up into that level, there will most likely be sellers stepping up right there. So if you're in it and you're looking to get out, you might want to Or at least reduce exposure. You might want to look for about 689 to 695 as a place to exit some exposure. It's Meeks D is looking at the Netflix. Very nice move higher on earnings. It's squeezing higher. In terms of targets, you know, I guess the problem is, you know, Netflix is a super volatile stock. We've got this this area to deal with from its last consolidation period back in September around these levels. And so it is coming back into some potential areas. Netflix is one of those where it's very difficult to fade both to the long and short side. And it's putting in its major moving averages are putting in a bullish alignment right here, okay, except for the 200, all right? So, you know, it's most likely going to catch a little bit more momentum and then it'll taper off and then it gets a little bit more range bound. You know, until we see the next news event come out. So one idea in Netflix right now is to go out to maybe March, if the implied volatility is still running hot, go out to March and sell some iron condors. And that way, you know, maybe, I don't know what premiums are going for right now, but something like 160 and 80, if you can get some good premiums on that, and I think you can, because this is a very high volatility stock, that might be worth a look right here. Rig had some decent news come out with respect to liability exposure with Transocean and the Deepwater Horizon and everything like that. I don't like Rig because I don't see an actionable pattern. You know, 55 would be the target. I like Halliburton better right now with the move up to 40. I think that's an easier place to work from. U.S. Steel, my target's 32, give or take, and if you're in it, I would be out before earnings. Norm Cycles is asking a very important question. Last IWO, you mentioned not taking mathematical versus market structure trades. Could you explain where market structure begins and mathematical ends? This is referring to, you know, how I break down technical analysis. There are certain technical indicators that are mathematically based, okay? So rising and falling trend lines, moving averages, Bollinger Bands, MACD, all these others, and they do fairly well with respect to identifying support and resistance, but they're mathematically based and not necessarily reflecting the overall market structure of a name. So the purest form would be looking at where buyers and sellers last stepped in and when they came in on volume. And most likely, if we come back to that price, there's going to be some sort of memory there with which those buyers or sellers will step in again. And that's just simply horizontal support and resistance. And there's some other market profile related stuff with respect to market structure, but that's sort of beyond the scope. So yeah, I think horizontal levels work better than trending levels in individual names because they actually reflect the order flow that came through compared to a trend line, which just shows you the overall rate of change. Remember, a rate of change and a trend is the derivative of price action. Okay, very similar to how, you know, in physics we have position and velocity. The position is the first derivative, the position is the original, and the velocity is the derivative of the position, the change in the position. Okay, so those are my thoughts there. Notice TA is noticing Elon, ELN. Very nice looking bull flag. You can play it on a breakdown of 13. You can play it on a breakout of 14, 13. That's definitely worth a look. Whirlpool, they've got earnings coming up, so do be aware of that. But if we zoom in right here, very nice high volume move right here. It's consolidating. It's starting to get a little volatility pullback right here. And if some more news comes out with respect to earnings, okay, or at least if people want to get in, if funds want to get in before that earnings event, this could see a run. Okay, so 55.25 is the key resistance level to watch. Okay, and this is sort of a pop, drop, and chop pattern that I watch. Very clean level to play off of at 55.25 on a 30-minute chart. YNDX, nice little move right here, nice simple breakout above 20. As long as it holds above 20, it should be fine. It's not a pattern that I look to play right now, but it does have the potential to maybe move up to 2250. Okay. Let's see. Seelan Bindercon. You're welcome. Okay. Stock Trade Journal. We got U.S. Steel out of the way. Visa is consolidating. And I actually like MasterCard more than Visa for an actionable level. Okay. If it gets above 355, as it runs into earnings, that should be a nice little play going forward. Okay. Visa right now is just consolidating. And it saw a little shake and bake to the downside. And it's just in, you know, sort of a basing range after a very strong breakout. Okay, so I would assume that the overall longer-term trend is going to continue higher. So maybe the 105-110 bull call spread out in March. That could be a decent play. Feister's looking at CRM. All of the cloud space names have been seeing sort of sympathy moves recently. So FFIB came out, CRM came out. I'd put NetApp in that same bucket. What was the one that had a bad? Riverbed is one that sort of led to that overall weakness. I think Riverbed's a decent dip buy at these levels. CRM, if it comes back into 125 to 130, I think bear call spreads could be worth a look. If it pulls back to 110 and starts to fill that gap, then you could look at bull put spreads. Okay, so it's in no man's land for me right now. When I look at technical analysis, I like to play the extremes. And I like to play clear support and resistance levels. I've got resistance 125, support 110. It's just kind of in the middle. It's nothing that I see is a decent idea right now. And no actionable ideas. Zen Profit's looking at CRR, Caribo, strong move to the downside on earnings, on volume. I'm assuming that we will continue to see post-earnings announcement drift to a retest of 90. So I would focus on the short side there. LVS is one of the ideas that I like to the long side for a longer term hold on a 5-year weekly chart. This is just a monster base that's been going on the entire year. And if it gets and holds above 50, I think that it's due for a very strong continuation. It's seen a very big move so far. I would prefer reversion to 46 right now. But if it gets and holds above, you know, 50 to 51, a longer term time frame, I think would suit this trade very well. Zen Profit's also looking at EOG, just kind of consolidating right here. It needs to hold above this trend line, hold above this 20-day moving average. I'm a big fan of the February 105-110 bull call spread right here, looking for a breakout, but managing your risk very tightly, and I think that's a good way to structure your risk. What else? Norm Cycles is looking at ABH. Just range bound. There was some volume that came through. I don't know what was going on right there. There's not any sort of inspiring price action to the long or short side right now. I think you know, if you're looking to trade, it's not an opportunity. If there's an investable opportunity, I really don't know. Okay, the overall trend is down. I would focus on the short side right now. What else do we have? CHT, not CHK, I've got muscle memory. CHT isn't a bear flag, and if it loses 31.40, it should be a short. And BBG, it already has broken down. The overall trend is lower. I would not be looking to play this to the long side unless there was any sort of basing pattern. There is none right now. Okay. Silver Star 99 is looking at MCP, the rare earths. Okay, this is looking okay, maybe to about 35 to 37, then it might find some resistance. I'm just going to run through some other rare earths. SHZ for a break above 210 could be worth a look. And Rare Earth had a very nice, I wouldn't call it a pump and dump, but it was pretty close. Very high volume move at the beginning of the year. What I would look for, if you do want to play continuation in RE, I think this has a pretty clean pattern on a breakout above $6.50. Pop, drop, and chop pattern. Pico Times looking at Dendrion. News-based price reaction going on right here. So, you know, I don't know what kind of news is going out for Dendrion, but it is a biotech hand grenade. Do be aware of that. The overall technical picture looks pretty constructive. Another one to watch is HGSI, Human Genome Sciences, if we're going to talk about the hand grenades. And you also, I'm going to double-check Intermune to see if they've fixed themselves. They have not. IBB is the NASDAQ Biotech Index. And IBB looks solid right here. If you look at this on a five-year weekly chart, it's one of those indexes that has broken out. And there's a lot of very, very strong momentum going on in the biotech area. It's just very difficult to, you know, it's not my wheelhouse. And there is a lot of event-based risk in sort of this biotech space. So you do have to be aware of that, okay? You can't get that pinless hand grenade action going on. Silver Star is also looking at NTES, NetEase. I'm pretty sure this is one of those China internet names. If it breaks above 51, it's a long. That is just a longer term level to watch. Set your alert for maybe 50, I'm going to clear all this off, you know, 50 and a half. It's got this longer term trend line right here. But remember, this is more of a mathematical resistance level. The true area to watch is right here, 51 and a quarter. So if that gets through, it could be worth a look. Definitely. What was the other one? Baidu. Baidu reports earnings Monday. So it saw a very nice bid up. A lot of the China internet names on Friday saw a nice bid up in response to probably the Facebook IPO. But Baidu ran, QIHU ran Sina, Sohu, NetEase could see that kind of move as well. Legal Gambling's looking at Nuance Corporation. This could be a pullback to moving average play. Very nice high volume move, gapped higher. It's pulling back there. I don't like the selling volume that we saw on Wednesday, but it is pulling into a 20-day moving average, as well as potential price previous resistance becoming support at 2715. So keep an eye on it. It might be one of those where you wait for a shorter term basing pattern to, you know, get in, and then, you know, some further strength. It might be one where you want to buy on strength rather than weakness. Panel, P-A-N-L. Universal Displays putting in an inverse head and shoulders. It broke above it on Friday, but faded a little bit. My upside expectations, let's just say 52 to 53 into November resistance. Okay, so I would say that's your level to watch. You've got this pretty steep trend line connecting the most recent pivot levels. As long as it holds above that trend line, it'll most likely crawl into that area. Out of Downs, looking at IWM, we already talked about it, was up yesterday all day while the market was down. What do you think? Yeah, this is a very strong relative risk-on indicator. If we look at a chart of the IWM relative to the S&P, it's breaking out. So there is more capital flowing into small caps right now than the S&P 500. That's a risk-on measure. That's a bullish measure. Mr. Dayer's asking, are you buying the dip in WFM? Almost. I like this as it pulls into the 20-day moving average. I think you can maybe do the February 70 put sale. But yeah, it's one I've been watching, and I like it as it comes into that level. And we've got some other confluence at, you know, there's a couple trend lines to deal with. But as it comes into the 72, 73 level, I think that's a decent dip buy opportunity. Okay. WSDOU is looking at put credit spreads on Google. Yeah, and this is one we had focused on this week in IWO Premium. Put credit spreads, you know, bull put spreads in Google, I had been, you know, talking about, and a couple people got into them. We also talked about put credit spreads in MasterCard and Cabot Oil. So that kind of trade has been working out fairly well. We talked about Google on the gap down last week. I said I wanted bull put spreads, but not necessarily right now. It pulled back into support, pulled back to the 200-day moving average, pulled back into a gap fill. So it's looking okay right now. My downside expectations are not that great, but my upside expectations aren't that great as well. So bull put spreads are very well suited for this, okay? Sina, Synaptics, S-Y-N-A. Wow, okay. That's part of the Baidu move. And I would focus on day trading that, because if you try, I mean, you could make the case and say it's an episodic pivot, high volume breakout, and so on. I would focus on a 5-minute chart, look for support and resistance levels, and play it from there. Look for second day plays. So, you know, there's some support at 36 and two-thirds to 36.75. If it holds that, if buyers step in right there, then you can play it, okay, to the upside. And then there's previous previous resistance right here at about 35.82. If it holds that level, that could be a decent support buy. All these are very short-term trades where you're in and out in 30 minutes. And that's a really nice-looking chart. And for a position trade, that's not that bad of an idea, okay? Put credit spreads on Sina, though. That's not how I like to personally play put credit spreads. I like to play them into a little bit of blood, into a little bit of selling. Because think about the mechanics of put credit spreads and bearish volatility strategies. When you see a strong sell-off in a stock or a market, implied volatility will expand because the perception of risk is much higher to the downside in equities. Okay, so if you think that a support level is coming in, right, and your bearish volatility, your bullish stock in our trade matrix, that is a bull put spread. Okay, that's not necessarily my favorite to play on breakouts. I would rather, if you're looking at a breakout, you're looking for an expansion in volatility rather than a contraction. Okay, expansion and realized volatility. So call buys are much better suited to that kind of trade. 1973 Hog is looking at Costco, COST. I remember that very strong move to the downside. I did not play it, unfortunately. That would have been a good area for bull put spreads. It's most likely going to take more time to work itself out. If it loses this level at 78.50, it could be a longer term topping pattern. So do be aware of that. River Pod's looking at JNK. This is junk bonds. What we're actually going to do is JNK relative to LQD. This is another risk on kind of measure. This is junk bonds relative to corporate grade. If there's a very high demand for risk appetite, you will see more capital flow into JNK faster than LQD. There's a big level coming up in this particular relationship. If it gets above it, that's another bullish signal. Okay. Trader MCM's looking at Baidu. I think we just talked about Baidu. It's got earnings coming up Monday, I believe, after the close. I think so. Or maybe Tuesday morning, something like that. So we are seeing a little bit of an allocation to the upside into earnings. I would not play it like I would not be playing earnings directionally unless it were maybe bull put spreads. That might be a decent idea. But yeah, you could look at sympathy plays instead. The Sinas and Sohus and how do you say it? Kihu? Q-I-H-U? I guess so. Kihu. My Mandarin's off. It's worth a look. Adadeon's looking at MNST and let's switch over to this one. Okay. Let's clear this off. Remove selected. There we go. Okay. MNST, this is Hansen Energy, was Hansen Energy. They make Monster Energy drinks. I have mine from yesterday right here. Very strong breakout. It's really, really tough to say now's a good time to enter. I would look for a pullback first, okay? But a very nice breakout right there. Chipotle also had a really nice breakout. Those were my two food and beverage stocks, my favorites. I would love to see a pullback, maybe to 350. I have a dip buying system that I've been working on that does very well in a lot of things, and I might use that one in particular. That could be worth a look as well. I would love a dip buy opportunity in a lot of these names. That's why I want a 3 to 5% correction so we can get better bases, right? Better basis in all of these stocks, but everyone's thinking about that. That's the collective market psychology. If we could only get a dip buy, I'm going to enter in. If we do get the dip buy, then those looking for the dip buy, right, will say, oh, I'm glad I stayed out. Now we're really going to roll over, and then they won't re-enter. Okay, that's just the game that's going to be played, I think, for the next few months. Legal Gambling is looking at Mako. We're going to switch back over. Mako, as it pulls into 40, 41 is most likely going to be a level of resistance. I don't really see an opportunity there. RSKYRTG is looking at one of my favorite patterns right now in Jazz Pharmaceuticals. This is one of those biotech hand grenades you got to watch out for. But it broke out, right? It broke out on volume. And this is a classic bull flag pattern, right? And we're seeing an expansion in volume on Friday to the upside. It made a higher high, and I think that this is going to be a very nice position trade. I really like the March 50 call buy, looking for an expansion in volatility to the upside. Angry Bear, looking at WFT Weatherford. Well, if it gets and holds above 17, it's most likely due for a continuation higher. If we back this out to a two-year chart, let's see where we can find some levels. You know, it's just one of those, very similar to a lot of commodity stocks, just been in a multi-month bottoming pattern. It did break out above this trend line, and it's constructive so far. Maybe there might be some resistance coming up where we had this cascade waterfall pattern right here to the downside. So there might be some supply coming up, but overall this chart pattern looks fairly constructive. Let me double check so I didn't miss anything, because we are almost out of time. Chris Dress is looking at James River Coal Company. We were talking about the coals for potential turn. JRCC could go either way. And there is a support level, a very key support level at 620. If it loses 620, you can play it to the short side. However, I just have this feeling like if the commodity trade is going to be back on, coal has been lagging, and if the commodity trade continues, we could see a bid in coal. Okay, JRCC, not necessarily my favorite long right now on a technical standpoint. I think ANR has a better look to it. And has been holding up and making slightly higher lows relative to some of the other coal areas. Let's see. What else do we have? Marvix looking at WLP Wellpoint, a little healthcare action. Big move to the downside on earnings. There's a key level, 63.25. If it loses 63.25, it's probably good for a short down to, let's just say, 62. 1973 Hogs saying uranium stocks are hot. Let's look at Big U, which is CCJ. Nice little move higher, simple breakout above 21. That one's looking okay. Let's go to the small U's, the USU. Yeah, that's looking pretty good. These are penny stocks, so just be aware of it, that these can have a very high failure rate if the sellers do come in. USU and URZ. Seeing some nice movement. I don't see any patterns that I like to play. The patterns in these smaller names tend to trade a little bit differently than those high liquid names like Apple and Google and so on. NJ Hounds looking at CODI on a flag break. I like bull flags when they're not running into previous price resistance levels. So when we look at Jazz, right, there's not any sort of previous supply coming back up here. If we look at CODI, right, there is this cascade waterfall pattern that we had in July, right? And, there's just a handful of levels between 15 and 16 that could be some potential areas of concern. So, yeah, we can make the case for a bull flag right here, but, what's our extended target and what's the relative risk that we're willing to take? So it's okay. I would, maybe with this kind of trade, because there's a lot of overhead supply, it may take much more time to work off that supply. So a textbook bull flag pattern with a shorter time frame may not necessarily be the simplest pattern or the pattern that might actually come through. Okay. Sina is not Sina, the Chinese company. Yeah, Synaptics, I get these two confused. I'm pretty sure that Synaptics is, or maybe it had earnings, that's what it was. Okay. Nice move higher on earnings, on volume. That's an episodic pivot. That's most likely going to continue higher. When I say sign on sign, I get those two not necessarily confused, because I remember these price patterns. But sometimes I do get the companies confused as well. Geckler saying, Pipes, El Paso deal premium was ridiculous. They can't handle this low spot, ripe for consolidation. So El Paso, I don't know what you're looking for. They were a buyout target by someone, so I don't know what happened there. Just double check, run through some others. I think that's going to wrap it up. Thank you so much, everyone, for coming out to another edition of IWO Brunch. I will be back next weekend, I believe, for another show. If you want to go further down the rabbit hole if you want to learn more about how to trade options. There are two things that you can do. First, check out my option product, my video training product called Option Foo. It is 24 hours of video education for options. So when I talk about put credit spreads and bull put spreads and call buys and everything like that, if you want to learn how to properly trade those and you want to learn how the options market defines its risk, check out optionfoo.com. You can also go to my blog at investingwithoptions.com. I run a premium trading service where we go over how to manage your risk, how to position size, what kind of risk structure you want to do. We've got a live chat room, trade alerts, email alerts, and all those wonderful things. And our goal is to make you a better options trader. And we've done that with hundreds of traders. And I think you will be benefiting if you check out those products and services. I'll see you guys out on next Saturday for another round, and you have a wonderful weekend.